Hi guys, my name is Christina and welcome to my channel. In today's video, we're going to be talking about bubbles. And you might ask, Christina, are you going to make a whole video about bubbles? And yeah, and there are several reasons to that. First of all, somehow it is a question that I've been asked the most. How do I draw my bubbles? What software I'm using to draw my bubbles? And this is about my comic creation process. That's actually one of the most like questions that I get. Another being, how long does it take you to draw a page? And another one, how to do bubbles? And also, when I started to make my own comic, that also was my question. I was sure there is a certain software to create bubbles, and I was sure that comic artists that I'm watching doing this online, like for example some indie authors like myself, they create bubbles with some help of software. Maybe there is some program for creating everything. So when I was starting my comic, that also was my first question. Not like, how am I gonna make a good story? How am I gonna draw beautifully? How am I gonna, you know, understand the visual storytelling language? No. My first question was, how do you do bubbles? What software I can create it with? Where I can buy like a bubble kit? So that's why we're gonna talk about bubbles. And since I've been doing comic for several years, I actually have more stuff to tell about bubbles because they can be also very different. And so we're going to be talking about how to create bubbles and how to choose what bubbles to create. Basically, we're going to talk about bubbles. Hey, it's a channel about creating comics, and bubbles are famously from comics. So we're going to talk about them, and we're going to take them very seriously. First, what software do you use for creating bubbles? I don't know. Actually, there is some manga create some software for creating manga and like some manga effects that has bubbles built in. I think I downloaded it like 10 years ago to just test it, and it didn't have much options. Like, I thought it's gonna be like so interactive, I'm just gonna point my finger in the area that needed a bubble and bubble gonna just occur. But it was very stiff. There was like very few options, and I didn't have control over the thickness of the line around it. So I thought this, I can set it up. I can't. So I create my own bubbles, as I'm sure all the artists. So I personally create my own bubble. I'm gonna step in this side of the screen and show you how I'm doing it, but a little bit later in the video. Basically, there are several ways to create your bubbles. Before I share how I personally do this, I'm gonna just talk to you about the purpose of bubbles. What do they do? And how we can choose the correct bubble style for us. You could say, oh my god, seriously? It is bubbles! Like, what? Like, don't, you're overthinking it, woman! But honestly, it's important, because when you're creating your comic, it's not only the illustrations and the frames that you're using, but it's how you're presenting it. It's a cover, it's the color of the dividing lines within the page, it's the style of those lines, it's the way you do the page, is the aspect ratio of the page, is it a strip even, is it like continuous pages, or what is it even? And how you do bubbles, how you decide to show characters' dialogue, the spoken words, the ones that we can hear, versus the ones that characters think, versus sounds, versus narration. There's so many things, and I think it's very important to take it all into consideration, because you're creating the style for your comic, you're creating the vibe, the atmosphere, and you can add to it with those tools, or you can ruin it with those tools. So it's very important, in my opinion, to think how to do them properly and make certain decisions before you start. I think that's also fine if you start without knowing, and then as you go, you realize, oh, that's kind of what I want. And then you revisit and then you redo them, because they're not part of illustration, they're part of those compositional lines. I will be showing you how I personally build the page in like a video that is coming soon. And in this video, I'm gonna show you how I personally divide illustrations from the actual dividing elements, so you can go revisit and change them. For now, I have a video that is called my Photoshop setup. You can go there, I'm gonna link it down below. In this video, I'm showing my Photoshop file and like folders that I have. So basically, have all this organizational imagery apart from your illustrations, because sometimes you want to go revisit them, and don't add this to illustrations, because sometimes you're going to use illustrations for other things, for promotional materials, for some other posts. You're going to reuse this. For example, sometimes you're going to do flashbacks and you might want to have those images to reuse. So don't mix and match. Don't just paint all of that. Divide smartly your comic to streamline the process. So how would you go about choosing the style of your bubbles? Well, I can't just sit there and say, what are the styles of the bubbles? There are many. Basically, the more comics you see, the more comics you read, you will see how many different variations there are. There's no particular rules. You can do whatever you want. You can check what other artists are doing. You check what publishers are doing in their comics. And you can analyze it and come up with your own. But basically, creating bubbles or creating any sort of narration or creating any type of words presentation in comics, there is certain types of how those words appear. It can be narration, where you hear the narrator of the story, whether it's an actual person or you as an author doing it. Also, characters speaking, like actually out loud. Also, characters thinking. Also, there is potentially sounds, as for example, like you hear like footsteps or knocks and all like this. And also everything in between. For example, in my story, there is a magic that is called storytelling, which is basically something between programming and writing. Basically, they're using stories. They write stories that kind of code reality, and you can do so many things with this. And storytelling is done by actually characters saying those stories, and they're spoken in different languages, special language that they use for this. And this is not actual language that we can read, and it also like a part of a magical effect as I'm drawing it. So that would be kind of another version of how it can be. It's words, language, sounds integrated into illustration itself. So knowing what types they are, you can go ahead and choose which one you're gonna be actually using. For example, you don't have to have a narration. You don't have to have characters' thoughts. Maybe in your comic, you don't want readers to have access to a character's head, which is, I think, is a cool idea too. Or for example, your comic doesn't even have dialogue. Your comic actually has exclusively narration, or exclusively characters' thoughts, or exclusively those words that are coming from illustration itself and interacting with the reader. So you don't have to use all of them. First choice that you have to make is which one you're gonna use, and it is gonna depend on the story you want to tell. Again, as I'm saying in many of my videos, what is the purpose of your story, what are you trying to do with this, and what serves the purpose of your story the most effectively. But from this point on, you're gonna choose what you want. I personally decided that I'm gonna use all of them, except narration. Narration for me is a little different. So I'm gonna use my comic as an example, and I'm gonna step out because I'm probably gonna be doing cutaways, and I'm gonna make them appear here. So in my comic, I have normal dialogue, I have characters' thoughts, I have sounds, and I have this magical kind of words integrated into like magical effects. And I also have narration, but narration is done a little differently in my comic. My comic has several narrators. We open the story with the main character, Sekai, as a narrator of the story. She opens it with saying, like, I'm da-da-da, we're doing da-da-da, da-da-da-da. And the story is gonna close with her words as well. But also, as she's saying, she actually quotes someone else. So she telling the story that's been told to her. That kind of introduces a more complex situation with narration. So I have several layers of narration. So I decided I'm gonna use narration the same way I would use my magical effect. When I use narration, I kind of use it without bubbles, and I just put words, and I kind of trying to integrate them into illustrations color composition wise. However, I make them stand out and make it still using the same font and make sure that it is narration and giving signal to my reader that this is a readable thing. It's not like magic that is flying around. And to differentiate who this narration belongs to, I'm using the color coding. Again, in my story, people who use the storytelling magic, who are storytellers and who are using this magical words stuff, they usually have their own unique color. As soon as person starts working with this magic, the magic kind of gives them their own unique voice. So every person kind of have a color. And when I'm using narration, I'm using the same color as this person's magic would be. And I'm also using this as a tool because sometimes you know whose color is it because you already seen those characters using magic and you already seen their color. However, some characters you don't know the color yet. Some characters you don't know who they are. You just recognize narration by the color, and then later in the story it might be revealed to you. I'm using it kind of like almost a plot device, using a little bit of a mystery and kind of sending those messages to my readers. However, they're not to the degree like if you don't get it, you don't get the story at all. They're more like if you're paying attention, it's gonna be an extra bonus for you. I like putting thoughts in it. So I think it's gonna be a more interesting experience for a reader. So that's my choice, and this is my examples. However, again, I'm gonna step back in. Cutouts are done. But you have to choose this for yourself, depending on your story. So after you make this decision, now it's gonna be about how you choose your style. And again, style also depends on what your story is. And also it has to match your drawing style. Not drawing style, but like the style of your comic, which can mean the mix of styles, for example. For this also, you would wanna investigate and research different comics, different graphic novels, and see how they're done. I personally decided that I'm gonna make characters' dialogue and characters' thoughts as invisible as possible. And by invisible, I mean I'm gonna make them as standard as possible, because people who use two comics, they will not be distracted by them. It's, for example, like invisible font would be Times New Roman, because we got used to it so much. Stuff that is so common, it becomes invisible. This what I'm gonna use for my bubbles, because I don't want to differentiate it. Because also, for example, when you're doing dialogue, you can actually play with fonts, you can play with boldness of these fonts, you can play with sizes of these fonts, depending if you want to show that the character is screaming, the character is whispering, the character is, you know, has a loud voice overall, or you want to just, for example, you have a creature that just, for example, has like a weird low sounds, like as a voice, and you want to, for example, emphasize this. So for example, if the character is of screaming and we see dialogue, you can know who this dialogue belongs to. You can play with all of that. I personally, for my comic, decided that I'm not gonna play with all of that. I'm gonna make it very classic, because I don't want to distract attention from another visual language that I'm gonna be using. But you personally feel free to discover what they are and pick it for yourself. I would say be tasteful. Don't just put everything in there because you think it's cool. Use basic like compositional rule. Think about three elements. There is one main element, there is middle elements, and there is like a tiny element. So this balances the composition. So when you're using several elements, make one your main, one somewhere between the news here and there, and one then you use in like tiny occasions. This is one of the rules you can follow, for example, to make it easier for you to balance all the fonts and tools and all of that that you have. Another thing that I want to mention, when you decided, be consistent. I mentioned before that if, for example, you work on your comic for some time and then you realize, oh, I realize my style. So yes, please come and revisit if you feel like it. But I would say stick to one package of presentation that you decided upon throughout the comic, because it is a language. This is also a way of you telling information. You're telling it visually with your illustration, with the words that you're choosing, and with those tools as well. So if they're not consistent, your reader would have harder times understanding what you're trying to communicate. They will not know what exactly you're trying to do as clearly if you're changing it all around. So as you can see, there is no limit to what you can do with bubbles and with text in those bubbles. You can do whatever you want, and you can be as creative as you want, and just do whatever fits your story the most and what is the most fun for you. Now, having said that, I'm gonna talk about how I do my personal bubble. And again, I'm gonna step away and give some space to my screen recording, where I'm gonna roughly show you how I do my bubbles. So basically, I draw it all myself. You can say, oh my god, that's kind of hard, my hand shakes, but it's okay. You don't have to do it yourself. There is a lot of tools in Photoshop. You can use a pen tool, and then you can stroke the line that you draw. You can use geometric shape. However, for my comic, I like to draw each bubble independently, because I like the effect of live stroke and live line in there, and I like the freedom that those bubbles give me. And when I create my bubbles, I consider composition of the scene a lot. And this is also another point that I wanted to mention to you. Don't just draw bubbles in just places where you don't have action. No, you have to put this much dialogue on the page and then just fill the empty space. Don't do that. Please think about what you're trying to do. If you have too much text, don't be afraid to break it down to several pages. Allow text to breathe. If you have a channel of text like this, it's gonna be harder. Again, if the text is slow, make imagery slow, make the pacing of the story slow, make the speed with which reader is going through the comic slower. So don't just fill it in. And also, it's very important to place it correctly so it's not confusing the reader, so they understand who is speaking in the first glance and they understand the flow of the dialogue. Western comics are read from left to right, and manga style comics are read right to left. Consider which is your comic direction of reading, and keep up with it. So if your comic is more Western style and it's flipped from left to right, as my comic, for example, so your drawing should be going logically left to right from up and to down, and the same should be for your text. It should go from left to right, from up going down. Keep it all consistently and check so lines of dialogue go underneath each other, or for example from left to right and then down, left to right, down. So don't confuse it, and if for example somebody is speaking simultaneously, point it out, put them on the same level. And also think about composition, because you're also drawing a comic, you're not just smacking it on top just randomly. As I'm outlining my chapters, I put like text clunks. Is it the word? I don't know. Chunks. Yes. Oh god. But basically, I put chunks of text in different areas, and I'm kind of planning the composition of it. And as I'm drawing, I also drawing with this text in mind. I already know the amount of text. I already plan where it's gonna be, how it's gonna flow, and I draw around it. This is what I suggest you do. Don't just randomly do it. Plan it, and plan it compositionally. What I'm doing in my comic, I'm gonna be using tools that I already established only for all my bubbles, all my text and whatnot. But I will be playing with effects with it. How I'm gonna be doing it is I'm gonna play with only those rules that I already established. And if I need to create something creative, I would use the rules that I already have. For example, in this scene, you see my character is using magic for the first time, and what she's using storytelling, but she doesn't know. She's told to speak certain sounds, and as she's speaking them, they actually become magic. But she doesn't understand it. So when she starts speaking it, in her mind is just sounds, and reader is the first time for the reader seeing that. So I decided to mesh the two tools that I have, which is like a standard bubbles and magical elements, and make one transition to another and show that, ooh, actually those are words, and if you use them certain ways, they actually become magic. That's an effect that I created, but also I played with the rules that I have. I just mixed the two that I already have, and I think it's a good idea to play with this, and that actually will be interesting for your reader, because they already know the rules, and when you're using them, they go like, I know what you're doing here, because you're not tricking them, you're showing them what they already know. So I guess there's so much more to say on the subject, however, I think this for now is a good base to begin with, and then I'm gonna create several videos on top adding to this. So this is the base, my bubble video, hope you enjoyed, and if you're creating comic right now, please leave me a link to this below so I can see your bubbles, share your bubbles, wear your bubbles with pride, and I hope I can see you in another video. Thank you so much guys for watching. You can check out other videos on my channel. If you're new here, consider subscribing. I have a lot of videos like this earlier, a very cringy, but hopefully I'm improving and become less shy in front of camera. We become besties. I feel comfortable more or less. So thank you so much for watching guys, and yeah, thank you. Have a good day.